just like all other countries, we've been facing the same challenges. And since Angola, even before the pandemic, was undergoing very structural reforms, political reforms, economical reforms, we were entitled to be able not only to keep going those reforms, but also to tackle the negative impact of the pandemic. Nevertheless, we also thought that we as a country, since the start of President João Lourenço's new government, we thought that it was important to strengthen the role of institutions and also the improvement of market conditions. And therefore, the Angolan government established pillars of good governance, focusing itself on anti-corruption and economic diversification. That's on one hand. On the other hand, we passed a new investment law, 1018, which sets out competitive conditions for private investors to come into Angola. That same private investment law was based in establishing three investment regimes, the possibility of negotiation of incentives. There is no minimum required of amount of funds for an investor, and also for foreign investors are not obliged to have a local partner.
What about when it comes to diversification, given that it's really an oil-driven economy?
The new government has established a set of priorities besides tackling corruption, besides getting things ready for a restart of Angola. It is important to deliver in such a manner that these measures are reflected positively in people's lives. And therefore, we managed to set up a concrete plan, which we call PRODESI. Is a program of the government of import substitutions and to promote exports. It's set up in the sectors like the agriculture, manufacturing, mining, fisheries, ICT, health sector, infrastructure. So a variety of sectors that which we believe because of their relationship and the impact that they can have on people's lives, that they should be the ones to be promoted.
Some investors, many investors, look to countries that are politically stable before they come in. You talked about one of the pillars being good governance. There have been a lot going on the political front. We're not going to get into politics, but what do you tell investors to reassure them that there is a political stability and they can come in?
We invite them to come and to be able to see it by themselves, how these changes are effective and what the government is pursuing to pass to the general public a strong message of those changes. And as a fact, if you are following as a journalist, you have noticed that Moody has upgraded Angola's rating to B3, which is very positive. That means that the consistency of the reforms, the ones that are more related to the financial sector and the performance of government institutions and therefore performance in terms of governance, has improved a lot.
Now, Angola signed the Continental Free Trade Agreement, I believe, in 2018, and it's an Africa-wide free trade agreement to boost intra-African trade, among other things. What outcome and opportunities emerged from the move?
It is very strategic for us to be part of the African Continental Free Trade Area. By signing it, we believe that we are able to participate due to the strategic location of the country, due to the investment that has been done in infrastructure, both ports, roads, and railways, because we have a corridor that is called Lobito Corridor that connects Angola to neighboring Zambia and DRC. And it will enable us to have, let's say, a two-way movement. So on one side, we will have the natural resources coming from those countries, the minerals coming and being exported through to the Lobito Corridor. On the way back, we are able to send over goods that are produced either in Angola or imported from Angola through this corridor back to those two countries. So that will increase the trade between inter-regional trade.
Mr. Antonio Henriquez da Silva, thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.